Yes.
All right. So let me a bit explain why this topic has been chosen, and then we'll get started. So I've been working with customers based with their repos based on Terragrunt. So this topic is not something that I know in theory. It's something I use every day. And it was basically our inspiration for customer to use Terragrunt. So this is our achievement that we allow customers to use these cutting edge technologies from software side. So I will try to tell you what Terragrunt is and why should you not use that as well, and what kind of features, what kind of things it provides, and how can it help you in your current or future projects, if it will. So the agenda is as following. So first of all, we'll cover topics that relate to what the Terragrunt is, what this tool is, and how can it help you performing your task. Then I will tell you about main selling points, main features. Then we'll switch to several how-tos, how to configure this or that. And then we'll just conclude whether you want to use or you cannot use, or how can it help you. So first of all, let's talk about what Terragrunt is. So Terragrunt is a wrapper for Terraform. You need to understand that very clearly, that Terragrunt is not something that you can replace Terraform with. It's a wrapper for Terraform, but it provides several very cool features that can be implemented only with this wrapper. But also it supports everything that Terraform does. So it's a win-win situation when you have all the features that you have already experienced in a widely understandable and used tool and add something to it. Second of all, it's a very, very flexible solution. So you can use one feature of that or the whole bunch of it. So you can choose which of the features you want to use, which of the one you don't want to use. You can switch, enable, disable, and you can flexibly tune your solution to have what customers want or what you want most out of this solution. Third very good thing is ability to manipulate multiple environments. So if you have, say, three environments, dev, test, and prod, you can manipulate these environments from one place. You don't care how many projects or resources are there in each environment. You can manipulate on environment level. So this is much more convenient way to do things like configuration, infrastructure as code from this perspective. And the fourth, I would say this is the most precise thing for DevOps, is a simplification of configuration. What is that and how it actually implemented in Terragrunt, we'll see in the subsequent slides. But in overall, I would say that it just allows you not to repeat yourself. And the principle of dry, do not repeat yourself, I think this is the most important thing for Terragrunt developers, and they did everything that they could to implement dry principle in their solution. So what are the benefits that Terragrunt provides in particular? First of all, you no longer need to use multiple commands such as plan and init in the same folder. So it will do in a single command. Second of all, it will use environment variables as variables inside the Terraform code. So you can define global variables such as credentials for your certificate or anything that is globally defined within your repo, TF state bucket or anything else. So you can do that in the environment variable, and it will be available throughout all execution of your Terragrunt. Third thing is standardization. Standardization allows you to make all of your projects and folders and environments as much standard as they could. And you can define things on each environment level for each environment that you have. And you can do that from a single place, which will be your source of truth, which is also a very, very big benefit for any DevOps, a single source of truth. Also, you can reuse variables. So you can define them on a environment level and then redefine that on the subsequent levels as well. And of course, it uses the dry approach. So it will allow you to not repeat yourself in environments, in variables, in many different ways. And I will show you how. What is the business case for using Terragrunt? First of all, you should have at least three environments to start using that in start using most of the features it has, because if you have like a single environment, you won't use the certain features that they provide. Yeah, it will be nice to have, but still multiple environments are kind of a requirement for that. Second is a recursive update. So in fact, Terragrunt allows you to do a recursive update of your infrastructure. So for example, you have say a structure like that. You have environment, then you have some project, then you have some microservice and some microservice components. Say you have a structure like this, four layers. And you can update recursively from any of these levels. So you can update only your one single microservice or the whole project or the whole environment. So you can do that by using the embedded functions that Terragrunt has. But if you don't have that, you won't use that benefit. So if you don't have updates recursively or you don't use that, then you're lacking the most precise thing that they have in their solution. Third thing is microservices. So if your project has microservices, or at least it has projects of different kinds. So for example, you have a project that say has front-end, back-end, and database, and you run and provision infrastructure from a project level. So you have three, say, projects for each of these components, and you run recursive updates over this setup. This is one of the also the cases where you should use Terragrunt. Also, you should have a complex infrastructure. So if you have many projects, folders, organizationally somehow structured in different layers, then it's your case. And if a customer or you personally want to achieve a dry approach, you should be using Terragrunt as well. Let's go to main features in more details, and I will show you how things are done in Terragrunt. First of all, it supports inheritance. What inheritance is? So let's say you have an environment called env1, and you have a Terragrunt HCL file, the main configuration of this environment, and you can set all the environment related configuration in this single HCL file, and then in each and every app that is under this environment, you just retrieve the information from these main environment HCL file, which is very, very convenient. And if you have some other TF files, you can use them as well. So you have options to choose whether you want to configure something from the environment level or from the project level as well, or from app level as in our current example. So this allows you to not repeat yourself, because you don't need to define things within each and every application. You can define that on the environment level. Environment is a kind of virtual object in this case. So you don't need to create some resources on the environment level. It's just an organizational structure. Second very, very convenient thing is generated providers. So if we look at our regular repository, say we have three apps under one environment, and each and every application should have main TF file, which has generation of, for example, I don't know, backends of your TF state file, and providers which it should use within this application. For example, I don't know, Google provider and several others. And you should be adding this TF files in each and every application that you run. In Terragrunt, you can define that in a single place. You can define that in this HCL file that is in the environment level, the Terragrunt HCL, and reuse that in each of your applications in subsequent folders for applications, or maybe you have more interesting structure, more complex structure with different subfolders, and you can reuse that as well. And you can define that in a single place. And what, which is more important, you can change that in a single place, and it will affect all subsequent providers. So you have a place where you can update your infrastructure from and do not repeat yourself again. Next thing is a single source of truth, which I was referring to from the very beginning, because all you need to do inside your application folder is simply use the parent HCL file from the environment level if you don't need to re-init something or change some standard variables or standard providers. You can do it from a single place, and this will help you to not repeat yourself, and it will allow you not to generate more errors, because you can do it from a single place, and it will be used everywhere. And you don't need to go and change in each folder. The one of the most important things also is the command line. Terragrunt helps to keep your command line dry as well by adding variable extra arguments to each Terragrunt function. So if you have, let's say, a structure which has four different layers, and each layer includes some environment variables, in default Terraform run, you have to specify all these files by adding that with a variable file keyword and specifying the path to your TF variables file. In Terragrunt, you can define that on each level and never use that. So you will just use Terragrunt plan command, and it will automatically use all the variables that you passed in those files. How it's been done? Very simple. You add Terraform keyword, extra arguments, for example, variables, and add var file variables.tf4. So in each and every run, it will include that variable in this run of Terragrunt. So it will allow you to do things that you normally do with Terraform, but keep your command line dry. So you won't see all these arguments inside your command line, or if you automated your Terraform in some other place or wrapper, it won't show there as well. Also, I already mentioned the recursive plan, apply, and destroy actually as well. You can plan and apply from any level. I placed that so you can plan and apply from environment level, but you can plan and apply from any level you want, from root folder, from environment folder, from, I don't know, project and app folder, whichever you want. You can do plan all or apply all. Plan all will recursively go through all directories and show you the plan for these directories. And apply all, it can be done in two ways. First way, it will just do a regular apply for each folder, and each folder will specify if you want to apply or not. So you should be typing yes each time you want to apply, or you can say if you want to automate that, you can tell Terragrunt to apply recursively from any level, and it will apply in each folder. It won't be asking you each time, it will ask you just once. It will ask you if you want to apply recursively, you place yes, and it will do the rest. I will show you that in a real example at the end of our presentation. I can show you a plan right now, actually. I have prepared my repo. I will show you the structure a bit later. And if I run just Terragrunt plan all, it will go throughout all my repos and show me the plan that I want to apply over existing infrastructure. So it will go through each and every folder. And if you look at the command, it will be adding these var files to each and every layer I have. So I have environment layer and the project layer. So it will be adding that. So you can see that I have two folders in here, dev project and dev project 2. So it will do plan for these two folders. And you see, I have two instances pending application for my infrastructure. So we'll try to apply that at the end of the presentation. So these are three things that it can do recursively: plan, apply, and destroy. So it can do that from any level you want. Also, they have added before and after hooks. Why would you need these things for? First of all, you can execute some commands before and after the application. Before and after application. For example, you can copy some files from and out of the repo, or say you have some code that is related to your some lambdas or any other functions that you have in a separate repo, for example, and you want to copy those files to your infrastructural repo prior to applying the configuration. You can do that by adding an before hook to be able to achieve that within your solution, if you need that, of course, if you need that. Or you can add just verbosity to your command line tool. So you can add some info messages that will indicate, for example, who did this change, or what changes are pending, or some to-do list, or anything that you want to be added before or after the execution is completed. Also, you can, in the after hooks, you can, erase some temporary data from the execution folder, or there are tons of usages for such kinds of things as before and after hooks. So this is one of the convenient things nice to have, and they have added that in the Terragrunt solution. Also, it basically the Terragrunt before planning. So it will automatically init all folders, including the recursive run. So we will have our folder before run. You can just run Terragrunt plan and it will do it automatically. It also keeps your command line dry. You don't need to run two commands. You just run one and it embeds the init command. It could be customized. If you have some complex init command, you can also customize that by adding extra arguments to it. So it's the same as we did for our variables. So you can just add extra commands just for init command, and use that extra argument in their run. And it can be disabled, of course. You should just disable the auto init if you don't want to use that within your repo. That's also a good thing. Okay, now we're moving to a real how-to, a how to do things that actually help you to achieve dry of command line, dry of your code and inheritance. And we'll start with the repository structure. So this thing, Terragrunt is very dependent on how the repo is structured. And if it's not structured properly, it won't allow you to use some of the features. And it's better to comply with the following structure. So first of all, if you have some modules, you can initialize that in the modules, for example, folder, and use modules from there in your code. Second thing, that's my personal rule of thumb, I would say, to have a templates folder where you can place things that you use in each and every folder and just create a symlink there. And for as our example, I placed the Terragrunt HCL project Terragrunt file in this template folder, and I will show you how it looks in later slides. And then the main repo starts, the real of main repo, the environment folder, then project folder, and then you have Terragrunt HCL link to that template, the Terragrunt HCL file that I just mentioned. On the environment level, you also have a Terragrunt HCL file, the main file that has all related environment information and environment variable, environment related variables file, where you store your values to your variables. That's approximately structure that I have. And how it works. So project or microservice, let's say, Terragrunt HCL file looks like that. It just includes in parent folder. That's it. Three lines that you can make a symlink to, and it will use your Terragrunt HCL file. That's it. Environment, or let's say pod Terragrunt HCL file. First of all, you set the remote state. As in my I have Google Cloud and a GCS bucket as my TF state file. So I specify the bucket, which is TF state bucket. I define that with a environment variable, just to show you how it works. Also the prefix of the environment to be used in the Terragrunt, and the service project where this TF state bucket exists. Also, I specified the dummy bucket and dummy project as my default variables, just sure that at least it won't ask me for those variables upon the start if I didn't set any TF variables. Third thing is the extra arguments for my environment and variables of my folder. So I include variables in each folder, and then I include get Terragrunt there, which is a current directory, and I go back one level and use the environment variable, it env.tfwars, in my environment folder, which I showed you slides later. So I use that environment variable. And what's cool that I already mentioned is I can generate providers. For example, I want to have Google Beta and Google Provider within each every project pod I have. And I just generate them. Generate by adding this particular code there, and it will generate provider.tf file in folder and will allow me to use the Terragrunt plan and apply all the changes that I have. Without that, show you error because it doesn't provide it at all. Okay, now we're going to conclusion. So why would you want to use the Terragrunt? First of all, as you have already seen, less work for DevOps. You don't have to change many files. You can define things on a specific level and things define more generic things at the higher levels and then be more specific in lower levels. Less maintenance. You need to change less files. Let's name it like that. So you don't need to change more many files. Standardization. You have particular project that I have shown plan all from my dev folder. I have a very, very standard repository, and it will allow me to do things that anything that I want. If I add some complex things with dependencies, with some complex structure, it will allow me to do that. And it doesn't require things, but it structures your repository for good. Also, the clean command line, as I've already shown, plan all without specifying any variables files, and it will show you plan and applies applies things that defined on a environment level as well. And it's a very big canvas for enhancement. So you can use or not use specific things. You can define, we can define environment variables. You can ignore that, or you can do things like you just want to use plan all, for example, or just any recursive command. You want to use just this feature. You can use that, but then later on, you think of changing your structure and adding new things such as generating providers or else things. Then we'll go to why no. Why should not you use Terragrunt? First of all, if you have a simple structure, for example, you have one single project and you have, let's say 10 resources. It's a very simple structure. And you won't use anything from Terragrunt that it provides. You just waste pretty decent amount of time to nothing, and you won't achieve anything by just, you know, removing the command line arguments. That doesn't sound like a big business value added if you have just a single project. Also, if you're each of your projects has its own configuration, not depending on some higher level, as in our example environment. If this is your case and you have projects that are not related to each other and you don't want to use that feature of defining it from the higher level, then you don't need to choose Terragrunt in this particular case. Also, if you have a very big existing Terraform repository. So this is a very tricky why now, because sometimes if you have a really big existing repository, it will take you a pretty decent amount of time to structure it properly in order to Terragrunt to be can be used within your repo. And if you have that already, it's a big question if you will achieve that business value to cover the expenses for implementing Terragrunt. And the last thing is misusing Terragrunt. So if you use Terragrunt as a regular Terraform, for example, so you don't need to use inheritance or use it like a regular Terraform. You just init and plan and then apply. Then why should you use things like Terragrunt to invest some money? Time, which is equal to money, equal time. You just spend some time to implement that solution, and you are not using that properly. Also, if you abuse things that they provide, for example, you add 10 layers upon each other, and each layer has its own configuration, and your common line is adding 10 variables files, it's a very questionable thing whether you should use Terragrunt or no. This also applies to Terraform as well. Now we're going to conclusion. So what Terragrunt is, it's a Swiss knife, of course. It has different, very, very interesting things. Dry approach, structured repository, removes redundancies. You can do things from a single place. It has some very nice features just to ease your life. And of course, it eases the project creation process. So if you want to add some new projects to your repository, it's a very simple thing to do. You don't need to define many things. You just use that structure to enhance your project creation process. And now I will show you a small demo which I prepared for you. So first of all, now everybody can see letters from my console. So first of all, I'm located in a dev environment. So that is the root of my repository. Then I have environment called dev, and I have two projects, project dev project and dev project two. I have my Terragrunt HCL file, which defines the remote state. Then I have common variables. I just added before hook just to be just to use that and show you how it's defined. I'm generating the provider and I'm generating the backend. That's it. Okay, so now if I rerun plan, it will go throughout all my projects, and it shows that I have to add two compute instances. But if I go to dev project and show you. Here I have the compute TF, then main that's been generated by the Terragrunt. My Terragrunt HCL, which is a symlink to template Terragrunt HCL. And if I go look at Terragrunt HCL, it just includes the parent that I already mentioned and variables that has just a project name, and wars.tf defining the variables for my compute engine. So if I go and just say apply all. And yes, I want to go recursively, so it will do it auto approve without I don't touch anything. It will just create the respective instances in my okay. So it did. If we go to my Google Cloud console, if I refresh here, I said refresh here, please. Come on, let's edit. And edit in the dev project too. Okay. And the second one, okay. So it added in the dev project too, okay. Yeah, it added the instance dev one. So how it did, it used that environment variables, which defines the machine type, zone, region, and tag. So our instance is defined with M2 standard 2 in US Central 1A with the network tag called dev instance. So if I run the same thing from my prod folder, I won't do apply because it's a test. Account for Google. It won't allow you more than three projects. So I've used one dev and dev two for illustrating the dev project, and my main project as a service project. So I don't have more projects to apply in billing account. So I can't apply for prod, but still I can try planning that. So I use plan all for prod one, and you can see that now it tries to apply and standard four called instance prod one on prod project two. And the second one is in prod project one dash some random numbers generated by Google, and that's also with a N2 standard four. So that's how it works. I didn't include any variables here, so they are all included in the HCL file, which is very, very convenient way to do that. That's about it about the presentation. If you have any questions, go ahead and ask me right now.